All right, so we said Jeremiah, but we were in fact completely wrong. In actuality, the verse we were looking for is Isaiah chapter 45, and although the whole chapter is interesting, we are just going to reference chapter 7, and it reads, "I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. I, the Lord, do all these things." And so, basically, what we are trying to prove with that is, the serpent, in the garden isn't all that bad, 'cause all works, are the creation of the Almighty, and inevitably they serve for the ultimate goodness of the world and the ultimate purpose of the creator of the world. And so, it even reminds us of John, where it is mentioned that the serpent must be raised on. Actually, we're not even gonna attempt to go to that. But it, well, actually, yeah, we it just came to mind. It's actually John chapter 3, we believe. Yep, and as a matter of fact, it's actually John 3:14. So that kind of we don't know if that's directly connected to a true and faithful witness, but it reads, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." So now we have another way of lifting up the serpent. I mean, if not for the serpent, we would have never taken on this salvation, and I mean, I dare to say that it might have very well been the Almighty's intention since the beginning for us to make that mistake, and in order for us to become sons of God and being like God, So, there's a new perspective, a new point of view on this. Never before heard it, but it makes a lot of sense. So now, we've actually kept no order, but now that we make mention the raising of the serpent, let us kind of share a little bit on what we came to find out regarding Getayesus up on the cross. Now, the scream, the yell, when Getayesus yells, my Lord, why hast thou forsaken me?" That's actually coming from Psalm 22, but we know that that is in fact saying, my power, why hast thou forsaken me?" But it's speaking of, like, the soul is speaking. And what is the power of the soul? It is the spirit. The spirit breathes life into the soul. And so, basically, what's taking place is the sin offering. And we know from Isaiah chapter 53 that the sin offering is in fact the humanity of Getayesus, the goat skin, and therefore the soul. Or let okay, we kind of have to double check it, see if that is in fact right. Yeah, that is in fact right. And so the ram would be the body, and so he's giving up his soul. And then, but it goes beyond that. I mean, ones have to go and review the four gospels, because they all shed light into this truth. For example, one of the gospels, we know that it reads, to thee do I commend my spirit." And it says Holy Ghost, right? But we don't know if it's we didn't look into it, but to like it's basically we're giving ourselves up to you, Almighty, and because to fulfill this purpose, at least in the case of Getayesus, that's what's taking place. Now, it is also interesting to make mention that in for sure in the Gospel of John, Getayesus says something to the effect of, "Now it is finished." And the whole vinegar, it has to do with the soul because of that bitter cry. And so, but before we go to that, it is interesting to note that Genesis, the book of Genesis, chapter. Hold on, we're thinking it's chapter one still, but it might be chapter two. Well, it in fact is chapter 2 and it's verse 1. It says, "Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them." So, what we're trying to say is we're directly connecting that to the finishing when Getsaias says, "Now it's finished." And because we are going to introduce Abraham chapter, I mean, my bad, Genesis chapter 22. When Abraham is about to give up his son, his only son. So keep in mind, I mean, the Almighty says, "Now I know that thou wast willing to give up thine only son, you know, the son that thou lovest." But what about Ishmael? Well, what about him? He's not counted, you know. So forget about him. So forget about the soul. Forget about the flesh. Well, this, excuse, I forget about the vain imagination, the mind and the soul that has been created falsely with all these false I guess like experiences that we've lived and developing this false sense of pride, a false sense of our soul, basically our ego, our nothingness. And so what we're gonna say is if one's read Genesis chapter 22 and refer to verse 11. It reads, "And the angel of the Lord called to him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything to him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thine hand, thine only son from me." Oh, my bad. "Thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering instead of his son. So that in itself is explaining how the ram is the substitute, how that ram was provided for by the Almighty. And this is interesting because we were about to say, now we don't know because of what we read, we're not too sure if it's correct, but we're gonna put it out there anyways. And like to us, we were thinking that because the flesh and the flesh and the spirit were not given up. We were thinking that Yesus appeared to Abraham, and when that yell took place, the whole amlake, amlakahe, or I think it's amlake, amlake, and so on and so forth. We were thinking that it was in fact Getayesus, like I'm going forward in time to the times of Abraham, and kind of like that would explain that whole separation because the Almighty and the Father, Kedamawi Kailashalas, never really separated from Getsayesus. They were more correctly like it was a kind of like a action reaction, kind of like such pureness and such perfection was repulsed by the receiving of sin, by the, I guess like the, what's it called? By not only the corruption, but the taking on sin, you know, via the humanity and stuff like that. And so that's what we were thinking. And even we'll make mention with before Abraham goes up to the mount with Isaac, he tells his servants, just like hold on here, you know, wait for us. Me and the lad will come back. We're gonna go worship on the mount. And we're thinking that that the individuals that were waiting, well, Abraham's servants, that those are the same individuals that kind of told the disciples in New Testament, like, hey, what are you guys up to, you know? Because Yetayesus had sent his disciples to go into Bethany and to go and to take an ass that had never been ridden on, that had never bared a burden or something like that. And then if you recall New Testament, some individuals, oh my bad, Yetayesus even tells them, and if anyone asks, tell them that it's for me. And so I mean, we don't accept time to be exactly what they've made us believe it is. And so we're just playing with ideas here, but I mean, honestly, in all sincerity, it doesn't surprise I the least bit. And I guess it just came to mind, and so I'll put it out there. We think that Jesus Christos attended the coronation of his imperial majesty, to be completely honest, and that's coming from above, because we weren't even thinking about that, and it just came to mind, so we have to say it. That video, I mean, look it up. It's the coronation of his no, the coronation of King of Kings, of Kedamawi Kaile Selassie, King of Kings, and I think it has to do with Good Samaritan's blogspot, something like that. But the beginning words of the title, and it seems as if it's a name. It's Katal. We would have to look for that. Give we just 1 second. But there's this person that appears at the end, and you can never see his face. But it looks like his imperial majesty, but we have just seen his majesty, like, going with the queen Menen. It's we don't have the title right here, forgive me for that. No, here we go. Talaku Meri. Talaku Meri. So it's open brackets, Talaku Meri, and it's all capitalized, and closed brackets, him, it's HIM, all capitals, Emperor Kedamawi, and we think it ended with Haile Selassie, King of Kings. I mean, look, it's like 10 minutes in no audio, but at the end of that video, there is this individual, and we honestly, with all sincerity, we think that it's Getaesus Christos, because I mean, you just feel something, and the way that everyone kind of like prostrates themselves to this individual, being that the emperor had just gotten onto the wagon, I guess they would call it, with the horses and everything, taking off with the empress. It is very interesting, and the fact that they look identical, even though you don't really get to see his face. And I guess that's not even the topic. Let's continue with the topic. But that is interesting, because it came from mind for a reason, you know. And that whole time, I mean, do away with everything that we think we know. Truth very well is you know, more far beyond like any of the top science fiction films ever created. I mean, truth will the imagination of man cannot, well, maybe, okay, never mind, let us just continue. Because you know, yeah, there is some imaginative individuals out there, but their imagination is vain, you know. So let us continue. Okay, let us just do away with that conversation, but let us proceed onto the soul, I guess. Let us cover on the soul. If we Getaesus was repelled by sin, but it was his soul. He gave up his soul, basically. If we head on over to Lamentations, this is what Getaesus was feeling. And it is just something that we ourselves, even though personally we've experienced the first death, we don't think that anyone could ever know. We know that that nobody could ever feel the way that Getaesus Christos felt, because he was perfect. He did not commit sin, yet he took on sin. And so if we head on over to verse 11, it reads, "All her people sigh. They seek bread. They have given their pleasant things for meat to relieve the soul. See, O Lord, and consider, for I am become vile." And then verse 12 is the important one. "Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Behold and see if there be any sorrow like to my sorrow, which is done to me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger." So that day of the crucifixion, the Almighty, he poured out his wrath on Getsaiesus, you know? And as weird as that may sound, that is in fact very true. That is the wrath that was withheld since the beginning of time, that should have been poured on Adam, and therefore, you know, basically the end of all humanity. But every single action that Israel and the seed of Jacob has committed, the Almighty has kept back, and he has poured all that wrath upon his only son. And so, I mean, that in itself, if that doesn't kind of like pushes us to lean towards salvation, we don't know what will. But it goes on to say, and this is let us spring on over to verse 14. No, let us spring on over to verse 15. And it reads, "The Lord hath trodden underfoot all my mighty men in the midst of me." But we didn't do diligence to seek this out, but it appears as if men is not there. So it'd be kind of like, "The Lord hath trodden underfoot all of my might in the midst of me, in the middle of me, in the depth of me, even like in the vein, in the hollow, in the womb, in the belly, empty, in the depression even." But it's funny because it could be like he all my might, all my power, my power, my power, my might, my chayle, my chayle. And so it is kind of interesting. But if we read verse 16, it reads, "For these things I weep, mine eye runneth down with water, because the comforter that should relieve my soul is far from me." See, this is another perfect explanation of how the comforter, the spirit, the strength of the soul is the spirit. Without the spirit, the soul is left comfortless, you see? And so, I mean, we just wanted to make that connection. And even if we go to Jeremiah 4, and that'll probably contain way too much information. So let us kind of just go there and see what we could pick out of it. And I guess this is like to encourage ones to declare and to testify. It reads here, "And thou shalt swear, the Lord liveth in truth, in judgment, and in righteousness, and the nations shall bless themselves in him, and in him shall they glory." This is worthy, this whole chapter is worthy to kind of go over, because in verse 23 it'll go into, "I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form, void, and the heavens, and they had no light." So I mean, and "I beheld the mountains, and lo, they trembled, and all the hills moved lightly." Okay, this verse is necessary. "For this shall the earth mourn, and the heavens above be black." Turns out it wasn't the one. But the last verse, verse 31, actually goes into, "And the woman, that there was a sound, a scream, a yell, as if a woman travailed." And so it's kind of connected somehow. But let us proceed on to touch on, I guess, let us do salvation, because we kind of paused it, because we lost the verse that we were looking for, and we decided to arrange this a little more. And so let us speak a little bit about salvation. And so if once let us begin with Isaiah, because we're closer to that. Isaiah chapter 40, and this one, well, will actually also have to do with declaring the truth. But this is also, well, this is for everyone. But Ras Tefere, pay close attention, because here's like good scripture to support the truth. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. Keep in mind, the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. That is very worthy of understanding. But the word of our God shall stand forever. Lift up thy voice with strength. Lift it up. Be not afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. And so on and so forth. And we're just picking verses here. One's due diligence to seek him out. It's all in chapter 40, Prophet Isaiah. To whom then will ye liken God? Or what likeness will ye compare him to? Or what likeness will ye compare to him? Have ye not known? Have ye not heard? Hath it not been told you from the beginning? Have ye not understood from the foundations of the earth? So, I mean, all of these are very significant. To whom then will ye liken me? Or shall I be equal? Said the Holy One. And we say he be equal to I and I as Ras Tefere, one. We are all one in the corporation of Christ, in the body of Christ, and we all take on our governmental responsibilities as soon as we kind of like do away with all the earthly things and make room for us to carry some of the government's burden. And it's interesting because the constitution of Ethiopia, it reads, and this is Article 6, as soon as the unborn child is born, then he takes his responsibility as heir to the throne. And so that would be very interesting for ones to check out. We've always thought that it was I and I, but until we stand as one in and through Jesus Christos, that cannot come to pass. But it is in there. It is Article number 6. It is concerning the unborn child. Now, I guess let us. There's another verse that we need to point out in this chapter, but we'll leave that for another topic. Let us go on over to Hebrews chapter 9. Now, this is for all Ras Tefere, it is, I mean, it's a gold mine. Chapter 9, verse 26 reads, "For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world." But now, see, the whole suffering since the foundation, we think it's because Getayesus, he's been on the sidelines, waiting for us to call him in, to throw in the towel and have him kind of like tag Jesus and have him fill our role as quarterback or whatever sport it is that ones can better overstand. Now it reads, "But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed to men once to die, but after this the judgment." So Christ, this is the critical verse, verse 28. "So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. And to them that look for him," this is the key, "for them that look for him." So there has to be some looking in order to, and we'll read, "Shall he appear the second time without sin to salvation?" You see, the reason why for the last 2,000 years, basically since creation, the world's been like pretty much in a hell situation, and even that could be related to the prince of the world. Since that time, there hasn't been salvation. Now, don't get into the technicalities of what about the martyrs of days of old, and what only the Almighty knoweth perfection. Knowledge and perfection. We know partiality. I mean, John know what he's gonna do with whoever and how he's gonna judge. But real salvation, at least to the multitudes, has not come until the second coming. But we are to look for him And if we look for him, we shall see him coming the second time. And that's the time that it counts, because that is the now. That is him coming with salvation in perfection, because Getsayesus, he took on sin and so and corruption. And so it is his imperial majesty that comes once more, bringing salvation. You see, that's what I mean, that is pretty simple. A lot of people would kind of like get upset at this, but we just said that the Almighty possesses knowledge of perfection. I mean, he's not gonna not save anyone else. I mean, he knows his workings, you know. Let us not, there are things that we must understand that we will ever never comprehend. I mean, basically, what happened before in the beginning? Forget about it. I mean, what, who cares? Why do you even want to know? So there are certain things that we just gotta let go. And you know, if it be the will of the Almighty and in through Jesus Christus, then we shall know. And if not, well, I mean, we're not here to do our own will and to ask what we want to ask and to do what we want to do. We're here to serve, and only in serving will we be allowed grace and mercy, you know. So now would be a good time to well, we have a decision to make. Should we go to spirit and the soul? And let us first do what should come as the best news anyone has ever heard. Forgiveness. We have been forgiven. Our crimes have been paid for. Our debts have been paid. Our balance has been cleared. The trumpets of Jubilee have sounded. We're clear. We could go to the theme park. The ticket's been paid. I mean, there's so many different ways to say this. People, forget about the past, you know. The Almighty has not beheld iniquity in Israel, neither in Jacob, you know. So that is so important, but that is also so like it is grace multiplied to a power that we know not, you know. It is the ultimate grace and mercy of the Almighty. Let us direct thyself on over to let us do numbers. Let us go on over to numbers, chapter 23, and we're gonna start from verse 23. I mean, really pay attention, because if this doesn't kind of spark some kind of inclination to actually doing your part, I don't know what will. I mean, this is the offer of a lifetime. Black Friday, forget about that. This right here is what's, this is what's good. Now, verse 23. Okay, my bad. I'm in another chapter. It reads here: surely there is no enchantment against Jacob, neither there is no oh neither is there any divination against Israel. According to this time it shall be said of Jacob and of Israel, what hath God wrought? Behold, the people shall rise up as a great lion. Actually, since being that we kind of lost the verse, but it is around here, let us basically say what's taking place. So this is the whole situation with Balak and Balaam, and Israel is, no, we gotta find that. Excuse me. Excuse me, we gotta find that. We know it's here. Yep. I guess give we just 1 second, please. Okay, actually it is here, but we overlooked it. Excuse me. We have kind of like attention. We're not gonna say it. We're not gonna condemn ourselves, but we have difficulties paying attention. And so it is actually verse 21. We read verse 22, and we should have, or actually we skipped on over. Well, who cares? Verse 21, it reads, He hath not beheld iniquity in Jacob, neither hath he seen perverseness in Israel. The Lord his God is with him, and the shout of a king is among them. So, I mean, this is clearly direct connecting us to that shout. But see, the whole thing of this, the whole matter is God Almighty is within I and I. And so he's looking out. He cannot see what we do, you know, in a sense. He puts everything in back of him. And, you know, this is, he chooses not to see because of the prophecy to come, you know, of Geta Jesus. The Almighty, even in all his grace and mercy, kind of puts away and he doesn't forget. He just chooses not to remember. So he'll answer you with such words as, "What are you talking about? I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. When?" You know, like, cause he's not gonna remember. Cause if he did, we'd all die. And this is also, I guess, symbolically, this is kind of how there's a separation between the Holy of Holies and the other part. And so only once a year, the high priest would come in with blood. And so that was being done to kind of keep Israel from being completely annihilated by the Almighty, under the knowledge or over the knowledge that Geta Jesus would eventually give up his own life for our salvation. And so that is extremely important. But once again, if we go to Genesis, and this is this will be the blessing of Jacob and the curse of Esau, in chapter 27 of Genesis, it's verse 32, I think. Yeah, verse 32. And Isaac, his father, said to him, and this is because Jacob had just stepped out. And notice how he stepped out quickly, right before Esau entered. And his mother, Rebecca, also made him the food quickly, you know? And so just keep that in mind. But this is right after Jacob steps out, Esau walks in, and he says something like, "Father, aren't you going to eat of my venison?" And then this is what Isaac says. And Isaac, his father, said to him, to Esau, "Who art thou?" And he said, I am thy son, thy firstborn Esau." Nope. As far as the Almighty is concerned, you don't exist anymore, just like Ishmael never existed. And then Isaac trembled very exceedingly and said, "Who?" Yeah, see, he's not going to remember. And then he trembles exceedingly. This is exactly the point in time when Geta Jesus is on the cross, and then the earth quakes, you know? And this is in Genesis 2. In Genesis chapter 1, 2, since the foundations of the world, the Almighty has declared it. And he, God is not a man that he should lie. So it says here, "Who?" And then, "Where is he that hath taken venison and brought it me? And I have eaten of all before thou camest, and have blessed him. Yea, and he shall be blessed." So basically, this is the same situation that's taking place in Numbers. It's like, "Didn't I tell you to curse him? And then you bless him?" So Esau's coming to get a blessing, but then he blesses Jacob again. And so let us go on forward, might as well. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry, and said to his father, "Bless me, even me also, O my father." And he said, Thy brother came with subtlety, and hath taken away thy blessing." And he said, "Is not he rightly named Jacob? For he hath supplanted me these two times. He took away my birthright." Let's not even go to that, but basically it's me, 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 Satan, Satan, Satan. He should have just been like, "Well, let it be the will of the Almighty, let it be the will of I and thy Father, and that, and if it be good in his eyes, then all be good." But no, Esau continued with this selfishness, that soulish person. So, and then that is what kind of like sparked the inner enlightenment within I and I. But when it mentions, "And Jacob with subtlety," that directly led us to go seek out the garden, and because remember the serpent, none was as subtle as the serpent, and so there's definitely like way more to connect as far as that goes. But let us go on forward to Isaiah. Let us go on to Isaiah. Isaiah, let us begin with chapter 44. Excuse we. Now, chapter 44, verse 22, and it reads, "Remember these," verse 21, excuse that. "Remember these, O Jacob and Israel, for thou art my servant. I have formed thee. Thou art my servant, O Israel. Thou shalt not be forgotten of me. I have blotted out as a thick cloud thy transgressions, and as a cloud thy sins. Return to me, for I have redeemed thee. O Israel, return to the Almighty. We have been redeemed." I mean, if that's not clear, it is clear. So, let us continue on to Isaiah chapter 38, and more specifically, verse 17, and it reads, "Behold, the peace. I had great bitterness, but thou hast in love to my soul delivered it from the pit of corruption." So delivered I and I, but the love of that soul, and that bitterness go hand in hand, and we said that because it has to do with the these people fulfilling scripture in New Testament when they gave vinegar to Gethsemane for him to drink. And so that vinegar, that bitter taste, that bitter drink is in fact what is being described here. But then it reads, "For thou hast cast all my sins behind thy back." And so he's taking us out of the womb, out of the hurt, out of the love of our soul, the depth of our depression, and has cast all our sins behind his back. Listen, even the scientific people, this would be kind of like your frontal lobe, throwing stuff out to the subconscious, and the subconscious, we know that doesn't forget anything, but it like nothing gets lost. Information cannot be lost. Energy cannot be destroyed, but it you don't remember. And so that would be kind of like an explanation, kind of like a simile of how the Almighty works. But don't get this twisted. See, a lot of people would just hold off with that and think that that is good. Well, you could play your odds and chances, whatever happens, you could play it as ignorant. And if that be the case, the Almighty will know it how to judge you. But I wouldn't kind of like wanna play my cards through ignorance. I'd rather live my life trying to figure out the complete truth, because if there is even the least bit of hypocrisy or lie or evil intention within you, the Almighty knoweth. You can't lie to him. And so these little scientific games are not to be played, because ones would continue on doing evil and say, well, it'll just be stored up in the subconscious and that'll be that. But then look at the world, So there's much to it. There's much more to it than that. Now let us basically, before we conclude, let us introduce Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and this will kind of set things up for us to conclude. But this will probably take a while. 1 Corinthians 15, and we are looking for verse, man, so let's see, the yeah, we're definitely gotta give us just 1 second. Verse 45, actually. It's verse 45, and it reads, "And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, and the last Adam was made a quickening spirit." So basically, we are to be of spirit. The soul is done away with. Now things are going to change in the blink of an eye. And that is all in here, the celestial body, the spiritual body. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall rise, shall be raised incorruptible, and will be changed. So our flesh, see, this is the beautiful part. We keep the flesh. We keep the flesh. The flesh is gonna rise from corruptible to incorruptible. And so that is why Quetzalcoatl was in the last chapters of Lucas Fuengo, the Gospel of Kiddush Luke, or Saint Luke. That is why Quetzalcoatl appears in flesh, and he's like, touch me, this is I. And we keep the body. So I mean, just meditate on that. I mean, I know what to expect, but it might sound a little crazy to some other people, but we keep the body and we keep the spirit, and it happens like this. It happens in the blink of an eye. And so, and even if one's review this chapter of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Hawadiat Paulos is going to make mention oftentimes repeatedly. Listen, if the resurrection is not accepted, then the Almighty would be a liar, and he is not a liar. That's not what he says, right? But it's something. It In other words, he tries to convince everyone that, listen, if you don't accept that the resurrection is true, then you're saying that everything's a lie. We must accept the spiritual and the physical, in a sense, is what we're trying to say. We didn't really prepare to go into that, but that is in fact the what needs to be said. I mean, just go over that whole chapter 15 of First Corinthians, and that kind of reminds us of Lazarus, when Quetzalcoatl said, "I am the resurrection," and he brings Lazarus back to life. He came back in the flesh and in the spirit. The soul was probably done away with, but that wasn't the resurrection. Even though he said this is the resurrection, we should have looked up the words, right? But the resurrection is to come. So those that die once, I mean, just kind of like look into it. We really can't put something together like instantaneously right now, but let us go on forward and continue. Now, Psalm 31 is where it reads, in thou, my Lord, shall we put our trust, and that is putting on Christ, basically our salvation. And we apologize for not being able to put it together all that well, but our salvation is putting on those three covers, is putting on the tent, is putting on the armor tried by fire, it's putting on Jesus Christos. No form, no comeliness, no beauty that man should desire. It's putting on the substitution. It's like, you take off your helmet and you give it to Getayesus, because he's gonna pinch hit for you, and he's gonna hit that home run, and you're coming home. Israel is coming home. And so, and Jacob, even the seed of Jacob. And let's not get into that, but it's putting on Christ, and it's that way the Almighty will look at Christ on us, and he'll be like, all right, they'll live, because if we see him and he sees us, we have, by the law, by the commandments, by Moses's law, we are already condemned to death. And so this is a spirit thing. But don't think that the I mean know when to like the scripture says, rightfully dividing the word of truth. We have to know when to divide flesh from spirit and spirit from flesh, and when it applies, when it doesn't, because both apply, but in different manners and different forms. And so let us continue onto well, basically what we try to say is that our trust is in him. Let us be dead, but let Christ live through us, in us. Just to sum that up. But let us make mention, we kind of just figured out, kind of in a sense. You know, when chapter 4 of the Gospel of John, when Getsaiesus says that he's weary, so he sits, he rests on the well, and the disciples go out and grab some food. Well, he rests his feet on the well, right? So he sits, and then he asks that woman for water, and that whole Samaritan woman and the well and stuff like that. But then quickly after, and it's let's go to that is John chapter 4, and if we remember correctly, it should be verse 31 or 32 or something like that. One second, please. So it's verse 32, and okay, let's start from verse 29, I guess. No, the woman left her water pot, this is verse 28, and went her way into the city and said to the men, "Come see," and okay, blah blah blah. Verse 30. Then they went out of the city and came to him. In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him, saying, "Master, eat." But he said to them, "I have meat to eat that ye know not of." Therefore said the disciples one to another, "Hath any man brought him aught to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work." And so that's interesting because the spirit is a quickening spirit, you know? And so he was weary, but because he wasn't doing the work that he was supposed to do, so he gets there to the well, and as soon as that woman runs off and tells the people to all the men to come check this out, Getsaiesus is here. He gets all better, you know. It's like if someone lifted him up in wings, and the disciples are like, "Come on, eat, you know, you were kind of tired, you know." And Jesus is like, "You know, I got some food that you know not of, and my food is to do the will of the Almighty and finish his work." And so that in itself is an example of the quickening spirit, how from being weary to being full and eating off of. See, this is another example of rightfully discerning, like, the spiritual and the flesh and the flesh and the spiritual. But if we go on to Isaiah chapter 44, let us go to Isaiah chapter 44. And verse 3, it reads, "For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thine offering." Offspring, it says, my bad. And so, yeah, basically. And let us go to just trying to give one some references. And so let us go on forward to Isaiah 40 and 31, and it reads, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as angels. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." So that in itself is interesting. So let us go on forward to actually let us just conclude, because we're probably gonna have to, like, break this up into parts. The best thing of all is the blowing of the trumpets. We're always going to get warnings. Nothing that has ever come to pass has passed before it have been told. You know, we are told if we're going to mess up, we're going to get a trumpet blow. And yes, some people might hear an actual trumpet. Some others might get a feeling. But I mean, know thyself, and you'll figure it out. But when you're gonna mess up, you're gonna get a blow of the trumpet. When something's gonna happen, something's gonna tell you. Basically, it just came to I. This is intuition, you know. Just go with your feeling. You know, whenever you're taking a test, they say, you know, whatever your first guesstimate is, take it, and don't doubt yourself. We have to learn to flow with the spirit, and everything will be good. This is intuition. This is how we are supposed to be intuitive and intuit the demand and the command of the Almighty. We gotta prevent ourselves from going beyond getting too spiritual. You see, even revelations, and at one point in time, John had to look back when Gittaias was called upon him, and when John turns around and saw the angel of the Lord, he fell on his face as dead, you know. He went too far, you know. And so that blowing of a trumpet was he kind of missed it. But no, he didn't miss it. He got a blow of the trumpet. It's like, whoa, 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 you know, like hold on, hold on, you know, get in back of me and stuff like that. And so basically that in itself is should be comfort. The Almighty will not see our, oh, this is interesting. I've always wondered why some Ethiopian monks have glasses, have shades. And this is interesting because some of the Mayan descendants of deities, it is said, but they definitely wore glasses. And that's kind of interesting because there's a similarity that's taking place. And it leads I to accept that when Gita when excuse I, when our father Kedamawi Kaile Selassie, when he was covering his face, even the picture that Wyndham Yaron shows us, could it have been that he did not want to behold iniquity in Israel and in Ethiopia? You know, that is just kind of like interesting because we notice that sometimes His Majesty, especially later on in his pilgrimage visitation, he tends to wear glasses. It'd be interesting to figure out to kind of do some research as to when he would wear glasses and when he wouldn't, you know, kind of like to prevent him from seeing something that he maybe did not want to see for our best interest. And so we'll conclude there. But if anyone knows anything about that individual, that person, I mean, some of the other we don't want to say church officials, but some of the other saints in Ethiopia in the coronation, I mean, they worship this person. And I dare to say that it seems as if they fall down face on the ground and kiss his feet. And this is the closest we have ever seen anyone being treated as Gietzai Jesus Christos. And we don't know. It is speculation, and we're not saying it is the case. But something clicked, you know, something tells Aindai that it might have been, you know, Getayesu's visit, you know, being present at the coronation. And we say this with all confidence because, you know, is the arm of the Lord too short? No, it's not. You know, I accept this to be way possible. I mean, not only in a spiritual sense is he present. I don't buy into none of this spirituality stuff in that sense, you know. When Getayesus appears to anyone, I accept it to be him in person right there, you know, breathing and even chilling, you know, if ones are cool like that, and he chooses us to be so. So yes, this might make some people uncomfortable, but we really don't care. We refuse to accept that the power of the Almighty, and especially to whom all authority has been given, is limited to just a spiritual thing, an imagination thing. Nah, man. I mean, we know it to be real. Now, it's not saying that person on that film is Jesus Christos, but boy, did people reverence him as such. And that is interesting. Not getting ahead of ourselves. But we would like to know if anyone knows. I mean, just check out the video. We're gonna upload some images. We took some pictures with our phone, but it looks like His Majesty, but how could it be, you know? Anyone next, I mean, the first person that would be reverenced in such a manner and that could be considered to be more than His Majesty, although we know as Ras Tefri that they are one and one, would be Gietta Jesus Christos. And so that is just all we got to say. And so we give thanks. We hope that this has helped. Forgive we for not being capable of organizing something, something more organized, basically. And so, Shalom Rastafari.